Hello friends, this is our third class, third lecture. You can see, first one we saw practitioners of aesthetic response theories. They resist theory as such. Theory that means linguistically based. Then the second one that we saw, literary exegesis and also stable cognitive field and so on that we saw. The second one we saw, the resistance comes from language itself. Because language is epistemologically empty. It cannot produce, but it cannot present a stable cognitive field. That is, so language resists. You cannot present theory using language. Those things we have seen already, so I don't want to further complicate matters. Now there is academy resist theory. Why? Why does the academy resist theory? Reasons are here. They are very clear. I don't think any one of these reasons we should request further explanation, but still we will go through this. First is, today's program includes this. Academy resists theory. Why? It upsets rooted ideologies, revealing the mechanics of their working. Their working means the workings of ideologies. Ideologies are, you use language, and your language is empty of meaning. Yes. It goes against the powerful philosophical tradition of which aesthetics is a prominent part. That's also, I think, it is clear. Second one, it upsets the established canon of literary works, major works, list of major works. And for this, it blurs the distinction between literary and non-literary discourses. Literary and non-literary discourses, because both use language. And then six, it unmasks ideological aberrations. Poor readers of Marxist German ideology. In the essay he says, who says? Paul Dimant says. It denies the reality principle. Literature is fiction not because it is a product of imagination or things like that, but because language is unable to present reality. It is politically and ethically shameful. That is some personal, I think. Then it reveals, because there is no politics, no ethics in this. It reveals the unholy relationship between philosophy and ideologies. And then, mimesis is the most misleading representation of literariness according to this theory. Mimesis, literature is not mimetic mode. That's all. Because then what happens, we will see. This is not a mere historical conflict. This is what he said, the conflict between these theories, academic theories, and the advent of this linguistic-based theories, linguistics, use of linguistics in the theory. So this is not a mere historical conflict. Scholastic literary theory versus linguistic literary theory. It's not just a conflict, you see. And then he says, historical conflict. In history there are many conflicts. 100 years war is a conflict. Isn't it? Yes. William Duke of Normandy, the attack on England, that's a conflict. This is all historical. This is not just a historical one. It's not a conflict between two modes of thought holding the same stage at the same time. If the conflict is just historical, it has only a limited theoretical interest. That means one comes after the other. One theory comes, another theory comes. But it's not like that. This is, theories are historical, not ahistorical, ahistorical. Jesus said God is ahistorical. So God is, there's no history for God. Like that. Means you cannot say this is just a conflict. Conflict of two modes of thought. No. It is there right from time immemorial. But it's now coming up. Then there is a quotation from the essay. The attack reflects the anxiety of the aggressors. rather than the guilt of the accused. Who is the accused here? Paul Dimon. Who are the aggressors? The academy. Why are they so anxious? 10 reasons given here. That is why they are attacking. The essay is a version of deconstruction. Actually, this is also another version of deconstruction. Paul Dimon and Derrida, they used to meet at Yale's. But both worked independently, that's it. So one brought out same ideas in one another way, and Paul Dimon brings sign structure and so of grammatology, see prayer of the signs, etc. You can see, or you find the difference and deference is equal to deference, these ideas, trace, so these are ideas brought out by, or you can say, propounded by Derrida in connection with the deconstruction. But here in this essay, says that he also says language is empty, epistemologically empty. Same thing, Paul Dimon also says. So thinking is almost the same way, but they are reaching, the roots are different, that's all. That's why so much of interest has been shown in this essay. The resistance to theory. So why does academy resist? And then the conclusion is, it reveals the anxiety of the aggressors rather than the guilt of the accused. That's a beautiful sentence. Something like T.S. Eliot's the present is directed by the past and the past is altered by the present. Traditional individual talent. Okay. So let's take one by one and then a brief explanation can be given. It upsets rooted ideologies, revealing the mechanics of their work. Already I said, no, there is poor readers of German ideology. Because in ideology, what you do is, you are using language. Signifiers, play of signifiers. They are all empty. That is, rooted ideologies, mechanics of their working means there is no ideology. What they mean is something else. That's the point. We don't reach anywhere. There's no end point. If we reach an end, a position where we have got a pathless wood. The wood is pathless. We don't know where to go. So you cannot say this particular ideology is right one, the other one is wrong one. Things like that. You cannot promote a particular ideology because nothing is certain. Secondly, it goes against the powerful philosophical tradition of which aesthetics is a prominent part. This theory is fighting against aesthetic response. Because aesthetic response, we have seen, this, you know, of course, is part of philosophy, but what happens here is aesthetic response is, as I have already told you, if you write an essay on on the color of this pen, the cap of this pen, and things like that. That is aesthetic response. You are not touching the thing. That is the core of it. All as I told you, if you have got a kutukuda powder, tin. If you are describing the tin, then that is just like aesthetic response to literary works. I think that is clear now. Third is it upsets established canon of literature. Canon of literature works, you know. Shakespeare canon, we have seen. Milton. So, all those great authors, they have been listed like this. Now, if you know what actually is literariness, most of these people will be, they have to go out of the canon. There's nothing like, as just now I said, person is directed by the past, because past changes. In canon, past changes. Mind of Europe, what do you mean by that? Listen, no such statement, or you can say such statements will have no value. And also you have to rearrange. The list has to be rearranged. And then for this, it blurs the distinction between literary and non-literary discourses. For example, you can adjust the prices, keep up your bright swords and you will rush them in Othello. Says the highest, he says, poetry, that's what he says about. Now, because he finds that there is something literary about it. But suppose you have a sentence like this, keep up your good books in the shelf. Actually, both are the same. Why one is literary, the other is non-literary? That's the thing. Or April is the cruelest month. The Jew of Malta is the cruelest man. April is the cruelest month, is poetry of the highest order. But the Jew of Malta is the cruelest man. No, then that is not poetry. That is not poetry. Why? So it blurs the distinction between. Because both the raw material is the same language. Both use the same stuff, language. One you say it is literary, the other you say it is not literary. Why? So it blurs the distinction. It denies the role of history and culture. There is another aggressive attack on this theory. In the theory, what happens is that there is no role for history, no role for culture, no role for aesthetic response. But you can see a whole lot of theory by Greenblatt, a new historicism, isn't it? Cultural studies you have now, these days. How do you assess a great work now? Culture. Culture is also another yardstick, NU. In universities we have got this as a paper, major paper. There is cultural studies, CS. I have taken about 55 plus lectures on cultural studies. And I posted in YouTube. Right from culture is ordinary by, I can add this. Culture is ordinary, yes. Culture is ordinary. And then you have got all sorts of things like the structuralism and culturalism. You have a culture industry. So all those things I have done. If you have got time enough, you can go through that, if it is useful to you, yes. And then it blurs the distinction, you are saying, denies the role of history. It unmasks ideological aberrations. So when you say class war, bourgeois, or proletariat, haves and have-nots, these are aberrations, this is. When you really take up, it has no meaning. Because our premise on which we are proceeding further is language is epistemologically empty. But we pin meaning, or if you load these signifiers with meanings, and then proletariat, what is it? And bourgeois, what is it? These are all ideological. Or is a man is born free, but everywhere he is in chains. What do you understand by that? These are ideologies. So, those things, he says, they are aberrations. Such statements are aberrations. So, it unmasks. When you proceed on this, based on this theory as such, theory, which is ahistorical, which has nothing to do with this history, biography of the other, then personality of the other, escape of personality, expression of personality, no such thing in theory. So these are all aberrations, he says. And 7 point, we are saying, denies the reality principle that we have already seen. Problem, fiction is fiction not because it is product of imagination, but because language is incapable of presenting reality. So the meaning of fiction even changes. This is a rooted ideologies. It upsets rooted ideologies. What is fiction? Definition. What is literature? Definition. All those things undergo changes when you actually meet theory. Theory power. at the advent of theory proper. And it is politically and ethically shameful because there is no politics in that, there is no ethics in that. Already you have seen aesthetic and ethic, ethical and aesthetics, aesthetic response. So wrong. As I said, the Kutikura powder, you are not speaking about the powder, but you are speaking only about the tin. That is aesthetic response. And then it reveals the unholy relationship between philosophy and ideologies. That is metaphysics of presence. Whatever is stated, that's what happened to you. When Derrida came up with this theory of deconstruction, what happened to Western philosophy? The entire Western philosophy was shaken because it was built on binary oppositions. You understand? Therefore, it reveals the unholy relationship between philosophy and ideologies. And last, mimesis is most misleading representation of literature. The definition of literature is, according to Aristotle, mimesis. And that is the most misleading. Why? Because you cannot, a non-verbal world, that is the phenomenal world, you cannot represent in a verbal, that is verbal imitating, so to say. Verbal imitating non-verbal world is impossible. So literature is not at all mimetic mode. You cannot say like that. Non-verbal, phenomenal world, language verbal. How can a verbal imitate, a verbal system imitate a non-verbal system, or you can say phenomenal world? Impossible. That in itself is contradiction. So it is not literalness. That's what Paul Newman says. So upsetting rooted ideologies, Aristotle's definition, out, brief candle. Life is a tale told by an idiot. Theory is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. Paul Newman, not me, Paul Newman. If you agree with that or not, I don't know. So the attack, as we have said, it is ahistorical. It is not, as we have seen, two modes of thought occupying the same platform at some particular stage, particular period in history. It is not a conflict between scholastic and non, that is linguistic, no such thing. It is ahistorical. If it is historical, it will have no value, it is. It's like any other movement. You have got romantic movement, you have to go to classes like that. Otherwise, it will have no relevance. But it's not like that. It's very serious. And it is, theory is ahistorical. Not ahistorical, but ahistorical. And then he concludes this section by saying, it reveals or it reflects the anxiety of the aggressor. Because of these 10 reasons, they are very anxious. The academy is very anxious. Oh, all that we have been talking about literature, literariness, tradition, individual talent, historicity, new historicism, classicism, romanticism, all those things have no value. Rooted ideologies, upsets. And also all the great men, list of works of great men, one after another, arranged, first rank, second rank, third rank, that simply disappears. Because you have to define, there's a new definition for literariness. This is the reason why, or these are the reasons why the academy resists theory. So resistance to theory, you have already seen now. First, theory aesthetics. Aesthetic response theories resist linguistic theories. Secondly, language resists theory because resist means it doesn't oppose, like incapable. When you are incapable also it is resistance. The opening lines of Thesilius, The Wasteland, April is the cruelest month, breeding lilacs out of the dead lands, mixing memory and desire, stirring dull roots with the spring rain. Chaucer says, April, one that April lay with his surest shoot. Full of life, but here dead. Why? The denizens of the baseland resist the advent of spring season. Resist means passive resistance. They are unable to move. That's why April is cruelest here. They are unable to move. Now I have just moved away from the theory proper, but is the response or meaning-based interpretation I am also giving. Now that's why that's there, but this is another view. It's not that as it has been said, as Northrop Frye has said about archetypes of literature, he says, nobody has appointed T.S. Eliot as the vicar here on earth, something like that, exact words I don't know. So the words of T.S. Eliot are not Ten Commandments. See, exactly like that we can say here, nobody has appointed Paul Dimon as the vicar of vicar here on earth by God to explain what theory is or what is right and what is wrong. That depends on you. But this is a view. That's what we should understand. So the resistance, April, spring season, where all the birds open their eyes and then sing songs and the flowers, spring season, people move around, go to pilgrimage and all those things, but they resist. Resist means not active resistance but passive resistance. Why? They are unable to, like the language here. Language is not doing any, I am not attacking, but the language is unable, incapable. That's a negative knowledge about language. Understand? Finally, as I said, this is another version of deconstruction. See, it's not a question of my agreeing or your agreeing. This is for us to discuss and also I to enjoy the polemics within, the debates within. How we look at literature and literariness from different angles, from Aristotle to T.S. Eliot. Okay, I hope that you are following. Not my opinion, or I don't know, I am, as I already told you when I was talking about April is cruelest month and so on, I was actually, what I was doing is traditional way of interpretation. Not applying a semiotic approach to literature. The semiotic approach is what these people say on theory. They say application of semiotic principles to literature, that is theory. Where you don't have any politics, no ethics, no values, no value means morality, no religion, no ideologies, nothing of that sort. As I told you yesterday, textual codes, they are looking at the textual codes. See, lost and found is a textual code. Lost and found. As I also told you, you can think about these things. I hope you are following my classes. In that case, it would be nice and you can share this with your friends who are interested in this kind of polemics and debates and acid thinking, something like that. I would call it like that. Inverted on acid thinking. Hope that you are enjoying. Bye. See you again with another dose of the same essay next time. Sometime next week. Okay. Bye. Have a nice time.